different spin on this joke. So two men were walking through a field one day when they spotted an enraged bull coming straight towards them. Now, I know some of you probably grew up in the city, but I grew up in the country. And coming home from school, depending on what type of fruit you wanted to borrow on the way home, that's the path we would take. Is anybody else can identify to what I'm saying? Thank you, Errol and Carlene. So if we wanted tamarind on the way home from school, we would take a certain route. If you wanted oranges, you would take another route. If you wanted mangoes, hello, you take a route. Sometimes you got to get past certain obstacles to get to the mango tree. How many know what I'm talking about? You see the bull over yonder and you're measuring the distance of whether or not, can I get to the tree in the back before that bull comes over here? How many had a childhood like that? I tell people I grew up so poor, but I wouldn't change it for anything. Amen? For anything. Okay, so back to my joke. So these two men, right, it didn't say anything about mango tree, but they saw they're cutting, taking a shortcut, and this bull comes charging towards them, right? And so they started running for the fence, as anybody would do. And so here is this charging bull in hot pursuit, amen? And they're looking back and thinking, oh, he's going to get to us before I get to that fence. So one man, Jerry, turns to John and he says, John, put up a prayer. Come on, we're going to be done for it. This bull is gaining on us. And so John's like, I've never prayed publicly in all my life. And this Jerry's saying, but you got to pray. You got to pray. We're done for us. Here comes the bull. And then John says, okay, I'll pray the only prayer I'll know. He says, God, for what we're about to receive, make us truly thankful. How many know that's the wrong prayer to pray when you're being chased by a bull? Amen. I like that. Glad you like it too. Oh, praise God. We all need a little bit of excitement in our lives every now and then, right? And some certain things will cause you and push you towards prayer. For those online, just go ahead and put yes in the chat. Amen. And so we give God thanks for this beautiful gift that he's given us called prayer. But let me ask you today, how many of you would say that your prayer life right now is the hottest and most passionate it's ever been? No. Okay, we got one in a room, all right? So how many of you would say that in the past you've experienced deeper intensity of intercession and your prayer walk was so hot, it was nothing for you to spend half an hour, 60 minutes, or longer in prayer? How many know what I'm talking about? Amen. Praise God. I got more hands there. Amen. The challenge for any preacher is, God, do I have the right message? Amen. For, you know, that season, that Sunday. And so, as usual, I'm getting dressed in the morning and, I turn on to one of the favorite preachers and guess he's talking about this same topic. And I said, yes, God. Amen. And so I want to talk to us today about prayer and why we ought to pray. You see, one of the things I discovered in COVID, in this season, in this pandemic, is I'm going to assume that you're like me and like, you know, millions of other Christians, rather than experiencing a deeper intimacy and a deeper place in prayer, that you found it a struggle to maintain a hot, passionate prayer life. You know what I'm talking about? Amen. And you see, I don't know what has happened, amen, but I want to challenge us today to reignite the fire of prayer in our bellies once again. You see, the enemy knows that he may not be able to get you to commit some gross sin. He knows that he may not be able to get you to head out and go steal from a bank. Yeah? He knows that he can't get you hooked on drugs. He knows that he can't get you into certain sins. Come on. But he will always try to distract and pull us away from prayer. will always, and one of the things we've got to do at all times is outsmart the work of the enemy. Amen? The Bible says that we should not be ignorant of the enemy's devices. And he knows that a prayerful Christian is a powerful Christian. He knows that a powerful praying church, amen, is a church that will walk in her authority and power. But he will do every single thing to distract us from prayer. Every lie, every single thing, we become so busy, so caught up in this and so caught up in that, that next thing you know, a day or two has gone by without prayer. And I'm talking about meaningful, passionate prayer. How many find that that's easy to do? Amen? And next thing you know, after it's, well, 2 or 3 days of not seeking God, not grabbing a hold of those that prayer altar, not going into our quiet place, it's now become 3 or 4 days without, I'm going to use the term, meaningful prayer. Because how many know we can all do the quick little in the car, rushing out the door prayer? But how many, when I'm talking about prayer, how many know that I am talking about that deep, passionate prayer that we can lose ourselves in, where the time just goes, amen, where we're in the presence of the Lord. This is what I'm talking about, prayer. Throughout the day, it's like, yes, God, help me. God, I need a parking spot. God, how do I figure this out? Yes, God. But I'm talking about grabbing the holes of the altar. I'm talking about going before God and praying in your prayer language, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, an hour each day. Amen? But I want to tell you that the enemy will use every trick in the book to distract you and I from prayer. And I want to say to you that it is a trap of the enemy, amen, to keep believers from praying. You may think, oh, I'm just tired. I think I was having this conversation with someone the other day. Oh, I'm just tired. I'll pray tomorrow. Oh, this suddenly came up. I've got to do this and got to do that. Amen? Oh, my mind is too full. I'm too stressed to get into the presence of the God. How many know that that is the time we need to be on our faces? The greater the pressure that we're walking through, the greater the stress, the greater the difficulty, the greater the challenge, that is the call for us to pray. It's almost like, just imagine that there's a flashing neon sign, you know, saying, pray, pray, pray. But what do? We try to figure things out on our own. The enemy knows that if he can distract us from prayer, amen, our appetite for the things of God will begin to wane. When the appetite for the things of God begin to wane, it leads to sin. Am I talking to real believers today? It's much easier for certain words to come out of our mouth. Amen? It's much easier to shrug off the nudging of the Holy Spirit. Am I talking to real Christians? Just tell me that I'm talking to real believers today. Amen? Because, you know, prayerlessness just equals powerlessness. Amen? We cannot stand against the assault of the enemy. We rationalize and make excuses. But how many know that in this day and hour, God is calling the church to pray as we've never prayed before? Amen? For the first time in my life, I've actually stopped watching the news. All I do right now, I turn on and I get the headlines and I turn off the news. Amen? We're just coming out of a pandemic, and then here we are, you know, monkeypox. Amen? And I don't know if you saw the report. It's now in a nursery with little children in the United States. One thing after another, amen, that would seek to distract and just to get us all in trouble. Amen? Charles Spurgeon, the famous preacher, says this: I know of no better thermometer to your spiritual temperature than this, the measure of the intensity of your prayer. Let me say it again. He says, I know of no better thermometer to your spiritual temperature than this, the measure of the intensity of your prayer. You see, prayer is linked to everything else. I'll guarantee you that if your appetite for prayer begins to wane, guess what? Your appetite for worship begins to wane. All of that, then your appetite for the word begins to wane. And the appetite to be in the house of the Lord begins to wane. Come on. Amen. And so I want for us to be mindful. I'm not going to say anything to you today that you don't already know. This is a reminder, church, that in this season of upheaval on the earth, amen, you see nations rising up. We have, the war in Ukraine still going on. The media is not covering it that much, but thousands of people are still dying. Amen. I watch the news right now. Taiwan and China, that's another issue. How many know, church, that this is a call to prayer as we've never prayed? Amen. It is not a time to relax and be comfortable and sit back and go, oh, well, God has given us authority on the earth. Amen. To release his kingdom come and his will be done. Amen. Oh, praise God. I have around 9 reasons why we ought to pray, but I'm going to cover a few of them today. Amen. First, prayer is a declaration of our dependence on God. Prayer is a declaration of our dependence on God. You see, at its very base, at the foundation, prayer is always a cry for help. Amen? It's a cry for help when life is good. God, I need more of you. Amen? I need your grace. I need your mercy. It's a cry for help that, God, I need your love, God. We sang about his mercy today. It's a cry for help when life is hard. It's a cry for help when we need financial breakthrough. It's a cry for help when marriages are struggling, when our children are not living the godly life that we've instructed them to. Come on, when their lifestyle is contrary to the word that was prophesied over them, to what God has shown you. When you look at the state of our world today, amen, it's saying, we ought to be saying, God, I need you. I need you more than I've ever need you. Prayer is a declaration, amen, of our need and our dependence on God. We all know Psalm 61, amen, where David says, hear my cry, O God. Attend unto my prayer. He says, from the ends of the earth, I will cry out to you. He says, for when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been a shelter for me, a strong tower, he says, God, from the enemy. How many has been there when your heart is so overwhelmed with the stresses of life? I mean, is your life so smooth? How many has been there when you've gone before God in prayer and no words come out? Come on now. Only tears, only that moaning, only that deep intercession. The Spirit of God is calling us back to prayer. Amen. When we pray, we're saying, God, I am humbling myself before you. God, I don't have my life figured out. I don't know how to fix this mess I've gotten myself into. I don't know how to restore the broken relationships in my life. We're saying, God, I need you. God, I need your help. Are you with me? Amen. So this beautiful story of King Abijah in 2 Chronicles 13, I want for you to open up your Bibles or take out your phones. I'm going to wait a minute while you do that because I want for you to see the story for yourself. 2 Chronicles 13. Just give me an amen when you got it. Second Chronicles 13. Praise God. I know it's up there, but I want for you to see the story. Amen. Chronicles is not one of the most popular books in the Bible. Amen. And it's one of those ones that we often overlook. But this is such a powerful story for us. In 2 Chronicles 13, what has happened? The kingdom is divided. after Solomon's death, amen, you have the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom is referred to as Israel. Southern kingdom is referred to as Judah. And so you have this king, Abijah, amen, and he is the king over Judah. Judah is the ones who did not go away from God, amen. They're the smaller group. And then you have King Jeroboam, amen, went away from God. And it says in 2 Chronicles 13, verse 3, I read it earlier, Abijah went into battle with an army of 400,000 able fighting men. Jeroboam drew up a battle line against him with 800,000 able troops. Amen. Right off the bat, I want to tell you about this king. He is not moved by what he saw in the natural. He is outnumbered 2-1. Amen. And then it says in verse 14, I'm going to jump around in this story. It says Judah turned, and Judah again is referring to King Abijah's. He's over Judah, the southern kingdom. He turned around and saw that they were being attacked both front and rear. Sometimes it feels like the assault comes from every side, doesn't it? Amen. And so, you know, you're fighting this battle over here and you think you may have a handle on it, but you turn around and there's another battle over here. Amen. And it feels like you are surrounded. But I want for you to see what King Abijah did. It says, then they cried out to the Lord. Woo! How many know that is prayer right there? It says they cried out to the Lord. The priests blew their trumpets. How many know that in the midst of being surrounded by the enemy, there is a battle cry and there's a victory cry that can go up in your prayers? Amen? And it says the men of Judah raised the battle cry. At the sound of their battle cry, God rooted Jeroboam and all Israel before Abijah and Judah. In the midst of being surrounded by the enemy, outnumbered 2-1, amen, God, you know, did his work. They cried out to God and God heard them, outnumbered 2-1. Listen to me, church, whatever it is that you're going through right now, it may feel like you're losing the battle. I mean, it is stress. It feels like one thing after another. I want to encourage you today to cry out to God. In the midst of it, stand your ground. Do not be moved, church, by what you see. Do not be moved by what you hear. Stand on the word of God. This is why we pray. We're saying, God, I am dependent on you. Amen. In 2 Chronicles 20, you know, you would read about King Jehoshaphat. He gets news that the army is coming against him. And what does he do? He sought God in prayer and fasting. And then the Bible tells us that King Jehoshaphat prayed. And he says, God, I don't know what to do. We do not know what to do, but what our eyes are on you. Amen. This is the power of prayer. This is what God has called us to do, is to be completely dependent on him. Sometimes it's a good thing. No, not sometimes. All the time, it's a good thing to throw our hands up and say, God, I don't know what to do. God, I need your help. Amen. Sometimes the deepest and most powerful prayer is simply, God, help me. I don't even have the words to pray, God. Maybe y'all haven't walked through some things, amen? But I've walked through some things where all I could do was just to sit and say, God, I don't know what to do, amen? And I believe that God hears those prayers, amen? And so when we pray, we're declaring our dependence on God. What the enemy wants for you to do is to trust in your own understanding. He wants for you to try to figure things out in your own strength. He wants for you to walk stressed out, you know what I mean? Overwhelmed completely with everything. Oh, hallelujah. Let me move on. Amen. When we pray, we're saying, God, I need you. Paul exhorted us to pray regarding our needs. He says, Philippians 4, verse 6, do not be anxious about anything. Somebody say anything. But in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving. Bring your request before God. Amen. When we pray, this is what we're saying: God, I'm dependent on you. Every detail of my life. James, you know, says to us, you don't have because you don't ask. You don't pray. Amen. James 4, verse 2, you do not have because you do not ask God. Is there anything too hard for God to do for you? Amen. Is there anything too simple that you cannot pray about? How many have been at work, can't figure out something, and you pray, and it's almost like, say what? Amen? Oh, come on. Wholly relying on him. Jesus says to us, give us this day our daily bread. Matthew 21, 22, Jesus says to us, whatever you things you ask in prayer, believe in, you will receive. God knows what we need even before we ask. Matthew 6, verse 8 says, do not be like them. Your Father knows what you need before you ask. I want to encourage you, amen, to not allow the enemy or even your own flesh keep you from prayer. Are you with me? Amen. That television show, that movie may be hot and sweet. Don't let it distract you. Amen. That book may be really good. Even sometimes getting together with family and friends, I encourage that. It's important for our psychological health. But we can't prioritize anything above prayer. Amen. I don't know about you, but sometimes it's like, I'll do it later. How many know what I'm talking about? Amen. And so now I find rather than waiting to, you know, when I go to bed to pray, because I know what's going to happen, 9 o'clock, okay, go pray now, even before you start getting ready for bed. How many of you have laid on the bed and say, yeah, I'm going to pray? Okay, can I just say dumb idea? How many been there, done that? Amen. We just got to recognize that prayer is one of the most beautiful gifts that God has given to us. Amen. And we ought to be people who are praying. I'm just going to jump ahead in my notes here. Purpose number two. Reason why we need to pray is to grow our faith. We need to grow our faith. 2 Chronicles 13:14. Judah turned and saw that they were being attacked. I'm going back to our story with King Abijah. Again, Judah, the southern kingdom, turned, saw they were being attacked. They cried out to the Lord. The priests blew their trumpets, and the men of Judah raised the battle cry. At the sound of their battle cry, God moved on their behalf and routed the enemy. Amen? But let's back up and look at verse 10. Now, I'm realistic. Practical person. If I'm going through something and I see I'm surrounded on all sides, the enemy's coming at me, what would you do? Run, okay? We can say we're all super spiritual, but our flesh is gonna say, hello, we have this expression, feet, I'll say it in English, feet, if you're not coming, too bad, I'm out of here, amen? But King Abijah and the rest of his army, look at what they did in verse 10. And look at King Abijah. Look at, this is what he says. The enemy, he's being attacked. And he stands up and he speaks to Israel. Again, northern kingdom, because the kingdom is divided. He says to them, he tells them how they have departed from God. He says to them, you know, God's word is true. He says, as for us, however, the Lord is our God. We have not forsaken him. The priests who serve the Lord are sons of Aaron, and Levites assisted them. Every morning and evening they present burnt offerings and fragrant incense to the Lord. They set out the bread on the ceremonial clean table and light the lamps on the gold lampstand every day. The significance of this is because Israel, again, northern kingdom, went away from God and pulled in anybody to be a priest, They made idols, but they're saying, no, no, we have not departed from God. Look in verse 11. He says, we are observing the requirements of the Lord our God, but you have forsaken him. Here is his faith statement. He says in verse 12, I want for you to get this. Highlight this in your Bible. He says, God is with us. He is our leader. His priests with their trumpets will sound the battle cry against you. Amen. People of Israel, do not fight against the Lord, the God of your ancestors, for you will not succeed. Here is the man surrounded by the enemy, and he is bold enough in faith to say, God is with us. We may be outnumbered 2-1, but God of heaven, created of heaven and earth, the one who parted the Red Sea, the one who appeared to Moses in the fiery bush, that God is for us. And he says, it doesn't matter what you're coming at us against, we will not be defeated. God is our leader. This is his faith step. In the midst of prayer, you're saying you're dependent on God, but I would tell you, it is also a faith step. What you're going through right now, what is your word of faith? What are you standing on? What are your promises? Oh, come on, church. How many of you know what I'm talking about to battle in prayer? Amen? That you decide that I'm not going to be moved by what I see. It is easy to react in the natural. It is easy to cry. How many have done a few of those? It is easy to lash out at the people around you. Are there real believers in the house? Amen? All that stuff, but I am telling you, when faith rises up on the inside and you can boldly declare and stand and say, God is with me. I am not going to be moved by what I see, hear, or feel. God is fighting for me. Jehovah is my provider. Jehovah is my healer. So, body, you're going to line up with the word of God. Children, you're going to line up with the word that God has released over you. And I want to tell you that in prayer, this is where you stand in faith and say, I will not be moved. Amen. This is where your battle is won. Can we understand why the enemy wants to keep us from prayer? Keep us busy. Come on now, because guess what? There's no faith being stirred up. But when you get the word of God in your mouth and you begin to release that two-edged sword, the enemy must flee. Amen. Just as we see here. Oh, hallelujah. It's your faith stand. Amen. He cried out to God. There was no fear in this man. He had a confident expectation that God would come through. Where are you in your battle right now? Amen. Are you standing firmly on the promises of God? Are you declaring his truth over your family and over your finances in the name of Jesus? And as a result, verse 16 and 17 tells us, amen, the Israelites fled before Judah. They were twice the army, but they fled. Amen. It says in verse 17, Abijah and his troops inflicted heavy losses on them so that there were 500,000 casualties among Israel's able men. Now, I don't know about you, how you read your Bible. But when I talk back to the scriptures, or I'll jump up and I'm sitting at my kitchen table reading this, and I'm like, I cannot imagine 500,000 men died in battle. Their opponent had half the soldiers. But what I'm telling you, when God is working on your behalf, amen, how many you have? Doesn't matter. It says the Israelites were subdued on that day and the people of Judah were victorious because they relied on God. Again, I want to encourage you, rely on God. When you are in prayer, amen, it's your faith step. It's your faith position. The enemy wants to push you off of that place. Why? Because the enemy knows Hebrews 11:6, without faith it is impossible to please God. Amen. He knows the word that anyone who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Amen. This is how our faith is established. It is this, in this place of prayer. Yes, faith comes. Bible tells us in Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing the word, and the word by hearing of God. But I am telling you, when we battle in prayer, woo, faith rises up. You know, church, this is why it's so important. Amen. Corporate prayer. When we begin to pray together, declare the word of God together, I'm encouraged as I hear one person release the word, another one releases the word. I am strengthened. Amen. I am told that one of the things right here in Canada, I met with a group of pastors, and their mandate, they're going around and you know, just individually on a Thursday night, just praying for different pastors in the city. And so a couple of weeks ago was my turn, and I was so grateful. But they said prayer services are dying out in churches. Amen? That many churches have just stopped having prayer service. That should cause us to weep. Amen? And the reason why they've stopped having prayer service is because people are not attending. Amen? And then we wonder why the church is not as powerful as she should be. Why we're not walking in the authority, amen, that we should. Oh, praise God. But King Abijah, he knows the word. And so he stood in faith. Amen. In 2 Chronicles 13, verse 5, I want to encourage you to read this story when you get home. You can read it in under 3 minutes. It's not very long. He says, he's telling the army, don't you know that the Lord, the God of Israel, has given the kingship of Israel to David and his descendants forever by a covenant of salt? Because he knew the word, he stood his ground. He stood in faith. Amen. And say, I'm not going to be moved. I am not going to be moved. Hallelujah. I'm going to have to skip some of this. Praise God. I'm on page 14 of page 26. So we're not going to finish this today. Amen. But it's all good. I also want to remind us for prayer, for it to be priority number one, church. Do not believe when the enemy says, oh, you can pray when you get back home today. I've fallen for that trap. Amen. We never get back into it. But we got to get back to that place and that priority of setting the clock back. Amen. Going to bed early, preparing for prayer the next day by going to bed early so that we can get up and seek his face. We want to walk in power. We want to walk in victory. I want to say to us that it's found in that place called prayer. Jesus doesn't say, you know, if you pray. He says, when you go into your prayer closet, amen, this is where everything happens. Oh, praise God. I'm just going to jump ahead and give you one more, and then I'll end there. Reason number three why we ought to pray is to love and fellowship with God. Is to love and fellowship with God. Going along with our prayer life not being where it should be, amen. I'm sure that you will also agree with me that the love fellowship with God is not where it once was, because they all go together. Amen? See, God loves you. Have you heard that lately? Let me just remind you, you are so precious to him. You are so lovely to him. He loves you with an everlasting love. You hearing me, Jaron? He says that you are the apple of his eye. He would go to the ends of the earth for you. He loves you and wants to pour out just more and more of his love upon you, Jackie. He cares about every single thing in your life. He says the very hairs on her head is numbered. Amen. He says that, listen, he says to Israel, he says to you, you are the apple of my eye. Amen. He loves us and desires for us to have this deep, intimate love relationship with him. I don't know about you, but for me, that is kindled in the place of prayer. That is kindled and stirred up when I take time out just to go and sit at his feet. Amen. When I put on some worship music, I get up in the morning. Amen. And I put on some worship music and I have my time with God. I pray into the Spirit. Amen. And I sense his presence. Oh, it's just glorious. How many know what I'm talking about? Amen. It's just glorious. It is the best part of my day. Amen. Is to spend this time in a love relationship with God. And I want to say to us, he's calling us deeper. This morning, as I'm praying and I walk and I pray, and I'm saying, God, Father in heaven, I just desire more, Lord. I am not happy. I am not content, Lord Jesus, with where I am at right now. I desire that deeper relationship with you, Father. God, won't you come? Won't you come? Take me on this deeper walk. Amen. I believe that's the cry of your heart. Is that true? Amen. You desire a deeper and more intimate relationship with God. And I want to say to us, it is found in this place of prayer. Amen. The Bible, one of the most powerful verses in Scripture, Genesis 5, verse 24, it just says this. I'll read from verse 22. After he became the father of Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Enoch walked with God. Then he was no more because God took him. What do you want said of you at your funeral? I know that's a sad thought. But Stephen Covey in the book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, one of the habits is begin with the end in mind. So how do you want it said? What do you want said about you at the end of your life? And he says, if this is what you want, then live your life so that this is what's said at your funeral. Enoch walked with God. How many wanted to be said? I walked with God in this fellowship. I'm just telling you, it's in the place of prayer. Amen. That our relationship with God is kindled and strengthened. It is with that. In Hebrews 11, verse 5, in the hall of faith, as we call it, it says, by faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. That's what I want it said of me. Amen. But God calls us into an intimate relationship with him, into fellowship. And I want to say to us, this can be kindled in prayer. I'm just going to close with this one story. Amen. I'm mindful of the time. A lifestyle of prayer is what we're called to. Some people, God would raise them up to be intercessors. And this is their day. It's nothing for someone to spend 2, 3, 4 hours in prayer if this is what God's called you to do. How many know that is a glorious thing? But for most of us, it is just a daily walk with God. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17. Short verse. How many know what it says? Pray without season. Now, I don't know about you, when you read the Bible, I read something like that and I go, say what now? Am I the only one who taught back to the scriptures? Y'all are giving me that funny look. Try it. It allows the Bible to come alive. It says, pray without season. And I want to say to us, it's having this lifestyle of prayer. I don't believe that this verse is saying that every moment of the day you're in prayer, because how many know that's not possible, because you got to go to work. You got to take care of your family. But it's talking about having this attitude of prayer that is continually flowing out of you. Amen? Is it Smith Wigglesworth? I can't remember. Who says, I never go 30 minutes without praying, but I never pray longer than 30 minutes. It is having this daily communion with God just throughout our day, speaking to him, hearing him respond. And so the story is told by John Newton. How many remember him? He's the one who wrote Amazing Grace. Did I get that right? Yes. Amen. And so John Newton would get together with a group of men for a monthly theological discussion. And they would address a certain question each month. And so they gathered, and this month's question was this verse, what does it really mean to pray without ceasing? So these men talked about it 45 minutes an hour, and you know, these theologians, they could not come up with a satisfactory answer. But at that time, a maid walked into the meeting room where they were at and began serving them. So one of the ministers casually turned to this Scottish maid and said to her, can you tell us, maybe you understand what it means to pray without ceasing? And she says, well, sir, you know, that's not a problem. When I get up in the morning, she says, I clothe myself. I pray that the Lord Jesus might clothe me with his righteousness for the day. She says, when I came down here before to dust the furniture in preparation for you men coming in, I prayed that he might cleanse me from the filth and stain of sin that wants to inhabit my soul. She says, before I set out this food and drink before you, I pray that Jesus might be my meat and drink until life eternal. So she says, sirs, I pray throughout the day. And that's what I think it means to pray without ceasing. I want to encourage us, church. Reprioritize your day so that prayer is priority. But I don't know how to pray. Well, Jesus knew that. Amen. And he promises us that Holy Spirit is there when we don't know how to pray. I want to challenge you, and I've done it before. Pray in the Spirit. Set a clock, 15 minutes a day. When you've done that, turn it up to 30 minutes a day. When you've done that, 1 hour a day. And tell me that your life doesn't change and that your passion for God is not ignited. Amen? That your desire for the Word is not stirred up and that you don't go deeper in worship. See, many times in North America, the church adopts the culture, wants everything quick and easy. How many has ever stood in front of the microwave and hurry it up? Taking too long. Amen. But this relationship with God that we desire, the power and the authority we want to walk in, the change that we want to see in our church, guess where it's birthed? It's in prayer. There is no other way. Amen? There's no other way. We want to see the change. We got to pray. In this season that we're living in this hour, we got to pray like our lives depended on it. Because it does. Amen? So I got through three things out of nine. It's all good. Would you stand with me? Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, like the disciples, we say to you today, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray, God. Teach us to pray. Father, kindle in our hearts once again the passion for prayer, a love for prayer. Show us, God, the power of prayer. Help us to see it. How many things have we missed out on because we did not prioritize prayer? How many battles, Father God, we have not seen the victory as we should, God, because we didn't pray as we should. Father, I thank you that you would arouse in us. You would stir up a fire in us for prayer. Father, whether we are 60 years old, 30 years old, or 16 years old, Father God, you desire to raise up prayerers in this generation at this time. Our nation needs prayer. The politicians need prayer. The schools need prayer. Father God, law enforcement needs prayer. Presidents needs prayer. Our prime minister needs prayer. Father, would you look in Mississauga Victory Church? And God, would you raise up prayerers, I ask? Would you raise up those who know how to take a hold of the altar? Father God, those who would spend in their younger years hours in all-night prayer. Father, would you do it again? Would you do it again, Jesus? Father, I pray that you would stir a prayer in our homes. Father, where we have allowed that to slide, I pray in the name of Jesus that mothers and fathers would gather their children for prayer. God, that it would be priority in the homes. God, stir it up, I pray. Help us to teach our children how to pray. Oh, God, raise up some 8-year-old intercessors, God. Raise them up, God. Father, for we need help at this hour. We need help, God. We declare that our dependence is on you. We cannot make one wise decision without you. Father God, we need your help. Stir up prayer in our midst, God. Stir it up in our hearts. We thank you for doing it, God. Give us that taste, Father, in the name of Jesus. And Father, for those who set aside prayer, because we believe the lie where the enemy says, oh, it's no use, it's not working. Father, forgive us for believing that lie. Prayer changes things. Prayer releases the power of God to work on our behalf. And so, Father, I thank you that you would raise up prayerers in our midst. In Jesus' name, we would stop trying to do things on our own. Figure things out on our own. God, let prayer, Father God, be in this house. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Are you challenged today? Are you going to say, God, help me to take my prayer life to another level? Amen. 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 If you need someone to pray with you, we're here. We will pray. Praise God. If not, there's some goodies at the back. Help yourself. Have some fellowship one with another. Amen. God is good all the time. Remember, we're not here next Sunday. We'll be at the park. We're going to be having some fun, laughing, fellowship, eating, etc. God bless you. Have an awesome, awesome week. Amen. I will praise you. I will praise you. Where you prophesy, still shout of heaven.